It's a pleasure welcoming you all here in the 7th session of Labernum Hall on date 5th December. It's the 7th session of this hall in Orange City Literature Fest, and time for this session will be 4:20 p.m. to 4:50 p.m. We will be now discussing about Chawl-life in Mumbai as a unique way of life with Kiran Khalap. Kiran Khalap juggles three passions and one career: brand consulting. His passion include writing, rock climbing, and spiritual evolution. The first 4 years of his working life was spent as a school teacher in a co-educational residential school in Banaras, India, run by the J. Krishnamurti Foundation, India. He is the winner of the Asian Age Indo-UK Short Story Writing Competition in 1995. Previous novels include Halfway Up the Mountain, 2003, and Two Pronouns and a Verb, 2012. He was the very first speaker at TED University, at TED's First Indian Meet in 2019, and at TEDx Bandra in 2017. He regularly conducts workshops on creativity and branding. As a branding practitioner, he was involved in the creation of the brand strategy and identity of Aadhaar. Handing this session over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for coming here. So what happened is, I was the CEO of an advertising company. After I returned from Banaras, both my parents were ill, so I needed to look after them. So I gave up being a school teacher in that school, and I came to Mumbai, joined advertising, ended up being the CEO of a company. And then in 99, when I started my own company called Chlorophyll, I had this sense of being independent. So I had won that award for a short story, so I said I must write a novel. So I wrote one novel. It got bought over by a publisher in the UK. I went to UK, US, read from the novel, talked about the novel, went to China, went to Singapore, all of that. Then Amaryllis, which is based in Bhopal, they said that we want to buy two more novels from you. So I wrote one more novel called Two Pronouns and a Verb. The first one is called Halfway Up the Mountain. Two Pronouns and a Verb came out in 2007. And then they said, we want a book on the Chawls of Mumbai. In Marathi, it's called Chawl. And I wasn't a newcomer to it. In fact, I was born in a place called Khetwadi in Mumbai. And I was born in half a 500 square foot room. So there was a curtain, and one couple lived here, and the other couple lived here. And the side that my father and mother was had a window. So they called me Kiran, because there was a ray of light coming from there. My father was from Goa, and most of the people who came from Goa lived in Chawls in Girgaon. So there was a very famous place there called Khotachi Wadi. If you ever go to Mumbai, or if you are in Mumbai, always visit that, because it's a very unique place. So I used to visit that very often. Then I had a friend in advertising who used to live in the BDD Chawls in Mumbai. And I'm going to read out two things. One is what BDD Chawls were, and then one chapter where the protagonist, so this is the third novel. So the first one is called Halfway Up the Mountain. The second one is called Two Pronouns and a Verb, and this is called Black River Run. Black River Run means, Black River is the road of tar, and Black River Run is a cab driver who goes up and down the tar road. So I'll read out what the BDD Chawls were, because they're iconic, and the sad part is, like everything else in life, they are going to vanish. There will be no more Chawls left in Mumbai. And then after reading this, then I will let you ask questions, because that's the best way of getting to know each other. The acronym BDD refers to British Development Directorate or Department, who built these buildings in the 1920s. They were originally meant to be prisons for the rising number of Indian freedom fighters, but over time got converted into residential tenements. The 195 buildings could house over 50,000 Mumbaikars. Rumor has it that in a city that gets over 240 centimeters of rainfall during its famed monsoons, the only buildings that do not experience water seepage are the BDD Chawls, since their walls are prison thick. They were built in four locations in Mumbai: Parel, Worli, Shivdi and Naigaon, of which Worli has the largest cluster of 121 buildings. Chawl is a word from Marathi, the language of the inhabitants of Mumbai. When I was writing this, I tried to ask many people what is the meaning of Chawl, and there were not really any clear explanations. So one learned Marathi poet hypothesized that Chawl itself could have emerged from the Marathi word Chal, meaning veranda, or from Chal, meaning walk, since a Chawl is characterized by the wide central corridor with rooms on either side. Chawls, like modern skyscrapers mushroom in Mumbai, represented communities, unlike the skyscrapers, since most homes never closed their front doors and the inhabitants moved freely between families. The community provided a sense of shared ownership of children who found warmth and succor in an adopted aunt or uncle when their own parents grew testy. In moments of crisis, the community extended help and hope both. Multiple governments have attempted to redevelop the Chawl since 2004. After several bureaucratic hiccups, Lower Parel and Naigaon were handed over to private developers for redevelopment in 2017. Worli's fate has not been decided. Next to Worli BDD Chawls is the famous Jambori Maidan, where Mumbaikars congregated during the freedom movement, started in 1885, to listen to national leaders, and during the mill strikes created by the labor movement between 1960 and 1980 to listen to predominantly leftist leaders. Today, the Jambori Maidan is famous for, arguably, the tallest Dahi Handi in South Mumbai, the festival of the birth of Lord Krishna, who could steal Dahi from a Handi hanging from the ceiling, recreates this scenario. The Handi is hung fairly high above an open space and teams of youngsters attempt to reach it by creating human pyramids. Are there Dahi Handis in Nagpur?
Yes.
Oh, lovely, okay. So this is relevant to you all. The Guinness Book of World Records acknowledged the record of a pyramid as high as 43.79 feet created by a group named Govinda in 2012, breaking a Spanish group's record of 39.27 feet. So I'll read one chapter and then we can have a question and answer session. The protagonist is wrongly charged of murder and he has been put into jail, but they have found a lawyer in BDD Chawls itself who gets him out on bail. So this is what happens when he's coming back. It's been just 12 months since that fateful dawn when BDD Chawls' own son, Prakash Pethe, arrested his own hero, Bua. Prakash Pethe was also born in BDD Chawls. Today, Bua returns. Not entirely free from the convoluted clutches of law, but free from a demeaning life in prison. Sushitai and Shalini have taken control. They don't want what the men want. No shouting, no dancing, no loud music, nothing that decreases the dignity of the man who looked after everyone who needed looking after. From Annie Besant Road to Worli BDD Chawls, there is a corridor of human beings. Not wearing any particular dress, not wearing any badges, just men and women who felt that they had been touched by the compassion of Bua. At the gate of his building, stand the people who refused to disbelieve his integrity. Jeru Madam is, to everyone's pleasant surprise, unrecognizable in a sari, dazzling blue and green, perfectly draped, accompanied by a handcrafted blouse. She looks like a queen, tall and unrelenting. Bua tries to touch her feet, but she won't allow it. She hands him one more Swarovski decanter, this time with a top notch of courage, and puts the chain around his neck. Inspector Prakash Pethe, who does not give a fuck what the world thinks about his exposure to the filth and lies in the media, waits in his civil clothes, in a white kurta pajama, carrying a garland of marigold which he drapes around Bua's neck and then bends and clutches his feet. Then they hug and have a conversation without words. "I'm sorry, Bua, I'm sorry. You taught me not to compromise my integrity in my job, even for those whom I love. That is all I did. It's okay, my brother, it's okay. We don't have to excel in every exam in our lives. Pakya, who will hack to death anybody who even doubts his own Amitabh Bachchan, leaps up in the air, wraps his arms, one strong, one half, around Bua's neck and hugs his hero, tears streaming down his face. Who is a dada, a gangster boss? One who is not bothered about his future. And a new definition, one who sobs publicly only once in a lifetime. A grinning Swarnavani, who is a lawyer, earns many tuplis of appreciation, obviously none as violent as the one suffered by the policeman who had come to arrest Bua. Shalini abandons her reserve and hugs Bua and sobs. Don't go away again, please, Bua, don't go. I'm so scared. Bua is silent and still, his hand on her head, the ignominy of being in jail has created tiny invisible cuts, but he can now feel the cooling balm of affection.
Hello.
So I had a friend while I was in an advertising agency who lived there. So I went there with him. So for instance, I know a man who, because of the riots, went to jail. And when I met him, he had a hole in his chest, just above his lungs. So the bullet had gone straight through him. So I visited the rooms, I visited their bathrooms, all of that, and that was the observation. So Bua is trying to live like, everybody here knows Swami Samartha Ramdas, anybody?
Yes.
So he's trying to live like that, and Samartha Ramdas went to a place called Shivthargarh, and it's a huge waterfall behind which there is a space. So I went and stayed there. So most of the stuff I have actually gone and experienced. So before writing this, I traveled with cab drivers for days on end, talking to them about what they went through, what their delights are, what their joys are, and so on. So that's part of it. Part of it is imagination. Yeah. 5 minutes. Anybody else? Yes.
So can we say that in today's time, chores are synonymous to something like criminal activities?
No. I think not all chawls had history. So if you go to a chawl in Lal Bagh, they were not involved in. Lal Bagh is more famous for the big Ganesh festivals. So it is a way of life in the sense that it's very communal. The very fact that no doors are closed. And if you come to Mumbai and go to any high-rise, all doors are closed. Most of us don't even know who our neighbors are. I live in a high-rise. I live in a building which has 32 floors. So to me, it very simply put, it's the difference between traveling by train and traveling by plane. So when you're traveling by plane, you're not facing each other. Everybody's looking in front. But when you're traveling by train, you're facing each other, and there is no way you cannot have a conversation. Right? In the first 10-15 minutes, you already decided from which village you are, whether your daughter is married, whether your son has run away, all those details have been shared because you also share our food. Indians are famous for carrying their own food and sharing it. So this face-to-face thing, that is what is key to living in a chawl, a kind of a communal life, which vanishes when you have closed doors. No, carry on.
Yeah, so, the whole essence of, we read Bombay and we read so many books which relates Chawl-life of Mumbai or whatever. Why do you say they're ancient? Because the government is coming down?
Yes, because most of them are very old. So everything in Mumbai is getting repurposed. They're all getting redeveloped, reconstructed. Now there are no new chawls being made. And so these are all old. These are all 1930s. They would take new residents. Yes, they would take new residents. But chawls are not being built. They were not built after 1940s, I think. So most of the people now live in slums, which are flat. Chawls are at least 2-3 storied. Yeah.
All right, yeah. No.
How do you differentiate between a chawl and a slum?
A slum will have tiny rooms and around small streets going. A chawl will be a full-fledged building with one central corridor and houses on both sides, or one corridor and houses on one side. And all of them are facing one side. They have much better sanitation, they have much better lighting, they have much... All of them have common toilets. There is no chawl with individual, what is called as aasut toilets. So those are their characteristics. The slums are just growing there. Most of them are unauthorized. It's very sad. The chawl life is much, much healthier, better, brighter than the slum life. The slum really has very little sanitation, very little power, very little... Yeah. And those slums which are very close to either the sea or garbage dumps, their floors rise with dirt and garbage and water. It's a very... Chawl is not like that. Chawl is a well-constructed place, but it has a way in which it is constructed, which is vanishing now, and which has vanished. There is no further chawls being built. Yes, go ahead.
Sir, how a Mumbaikar live with a time?
How?
A Mumbaikar live with a time. How a Mumbaikar manage a time?
How they live, manage a time. So, Mumbai must be the only city in India where people discuss train timings by the minute. So they say, me 4:35 chi gaadi pakadnar hai. I don't think any other city in India has this. Or they'll say, me 4:44 si gaadi pakadnar hai. Because they are thinking of that train by that minute. If they miss it, they are going to miss reaching office on time or reaching home on time. So that, this time pressure in Mumbai is more than in any other city. It's enormous.
If a Nagpur comes in Mumbai for wandering here and there, he is comfortable with the Mumbaikars, or it will be some embarrassment?
There won't be, you won't have any problems, but you don't expect anybody to pay any attention to you. Whether you're a Nagpurkar or a Punekar or a foreigner or whether you're Salman Khan. I'm telling you. You will go to restaurants where Salman Khan will be sitting there. Nobody is going to bother about him. Nobody is going there for autographs. Somebody might go and say, mere ko ek selfie de do, but beyond that, nothing is going to. They are too busy with their own lives. Not self-absorbed. There is enormous time paucity. They are poor on time. For every 2 minutes, 3 minutes, you are fighting. Time poverty. Do you want to come to Mumbai?
No, That's why I have asked you. And this
is
my first time.
Yes, yes.
Like, so, so, that's why I have asked you.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you have lived there.
Yeah. Yeah. मुंबई करण आणि नागपूर करण फरक काय भरपूर फरक आहे आय थिंक सो फ्रेंडलीनेस यू नॉट दॅट द मुंबईकर इज नॉट फ्रेंडली इट इज नॉट लाईक अ पटना ऑर अ बिहार बट ॲज अ सेट बिकॉज देर इज नो टाईम सो इफ यू से कॅन यू टेल मी द वे टू सो अँड सो मला हात दाखवाल का ही विल शो यू द वे बट ही मे नॉट वॉक विथ यू द एंटायर डिस्टन्स So it's driven entirely by money. Because you come there, it is the biggest city of opportunities. I don't know if you've seen a video called We Unbeatables. Have you seen it? Who has seen it? Who said? You've seen it. Do you want to explain to them what it is? So there are these 28 children from age 8 to 32 or to 20 who have reached the finals of America's Got Talent. It's unbelievable. So that ability to provide opportunity, whoever you are, what is your caste, what is your class, what is your surname, what is your history, in Mumbai, nobody gives a damn. That is the big difference between Mumbai and any other city in India. So if you go to Bangalore, you'll have opportunities in IT. But in Mumbai, the barber will have an opportunity. The panwala will have an opportunity to become big. Sorry. की आरेचं एवढे हजारो एकरपैकी मी दोनच एकर घेतले विरुद्ध पक्षाचं म्हणणं आहे की तेवढं सुद्धा करायची जरूर काय आहे आपल्याकडे झाडं एवढी कमी आहेत तर ते कापायला कशालाच पाहिजे तुम्ही दुसरीकडे कुठे तरी घ्या ही दोन्ही बाजूनी ते त्यांचे आर्ग्युमेंट्स ते आपण आता पॉलिटिक्समध्ये चाललो आपण शहराबद्दल बोलू आता ओके
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. On behalf of Orange City Literature Festival, we sincerely express our gratitude towards your expectance for the session and knowledge shared with us. Our next session is Chitra Takma Kadambari Lekhan with Shubhangi Bharbade.